Before we get started, I just want to let you know that we have some limited time only solar eclipse merch for sale at the merch store. I'll tell you more at the end of the episode. Space seems pretty fundamental. I mean, to build a universe, surely you need something to build it on or in. But many, maybe even most physicists now think that the fabric of space emerges from something deeper. And perhaps the most existentially disturbing such proposal is that our universe is just the inward projection of an infinitely distant boundary, a hologram of sorts. Let's see how this can actually work, and what the holographic principle really says about the realness of this universe. You could argue that the job of physics is to drill down and find the most fundamental elements of reality, the most basic building blocks, the ontological primitives from which everything else emerges. Now, a little while ago, we asked whether the fabric of space deserves that status. Isaac Newton certainly thought so, but many pretty smart people have wondered if space might actually be an emergent phenomenon. We've seen some examples of this in past episodes, from the early ideas of Leibniz to, say, modern loop quantum gravity. We've also seen how at least one dimension of space can emerge as the inward projection from its infinitely distant boundary. This is the holographic principle, which we spent many episodes building towards back in the day, culminating in a pretty intense coverage of this wild idea. Well, today, we're traveling back to the holographic boundary to try to understand better how the fabric of space can emerge that way. This will set us up to do a couple of things in upcoming episodes. We'll be able to understand how gravity can emerge from entropic forces on a holographic boundary, and how the fabric of space may be knit together by the quantum entanglement of entities that themselves don't exist in our familiar spacetime. Feel free to watch the old holographic principle stuff later, if you haven't. I'm going to summarize the core stuff for your convenience. So, the whole argument started in a surprising place, with Stephen Hawking and Jacob Bekenstein thinking about the thermodynamics of black holes. Normally, we think of thermodynamics as the study of the statistical behavior of many particles. It's the study of emergent properties like temperature and pressure of, say, a room full of air molecules. These are properties that the individual particles do not have. Another key thermodynamic property is entropy. We can think of this as a measure of the amount of hidden information in a system, information about the stuff that makes up the system that isn't reflected in the observable macroscopic properties. For example, this room, full of air molecules, has a high entropy because all of the particles' locations and speeds are hidden behind just a few thermodynamic properties that I can sense, like temperature and pressure. We wouldn't necessarily expect an individual black hole to have thermodynamic properties. After all, black holes are practically particle-like. They are the result of ultimate gravitational collapse of matter and are surrounded by an event horizon which prevents anything exiting the black hole from the inside. That includes any information about what exactly collapsed to form it. Jacob Bekenstein realized that black holes viewed from the exterior possess only three properties: mass, charge, and spin, almost like an elementary particle. But it's that exact fact that gets us to black hole thermodynamics and to emergent space. The difference between a black hole and an elementary particle is that the former is made by the extreme clumping together of the latter. That means we can define the entropy of a black hole, and the number is huge because black holes hide almost all of the information of the stuff that fell in. Bekenstein and Hawking figured out the entropy of black holes. They found that there's around 1 bit of hidden information per 4 square Planck units on the surface. This simple formula was really surprising, and that surprise led physicists down the path to the holographic principle. See, it's actually quite weird that the entropy should be proportional to the surface area. Intuitively, we might expect that the amount of information that can be hidden in any region of space is proportional to its volume, like 1 bit per tiny block of that volume, rather than 1 bit per tiny square on its surface. In fact, black holes represent the maximum information density of any volume of space. This is the Bekenstein bound. And that applies to the whole universe. The information about every particle in its 3D volume can, in principle, be encoded on its 2D surface. But it's one thing to say that all of the information describing a universe fits on its surface. The holographic principle goes way further. It suggests that we can think of our universe as really playing out on its surface. More precisely, that surface is its own lower dimensional space-time with its own particles and fields and a different set of laws of physics, but encoded in the patterns that play out in that lower dimensional space-time is an entire universe one dimension higher. It's as though the volume of the universe, what we call the bulk, emerges from the dynamics of its surface, the boundary. The journey from black hole entropy to the holographic principle was led by Gerard de Hooft and Leonard Susskind, but it was Juan Maldacena who gave us the first concrete example of how this could work in detail with his ADS-CFT correspondence. I talked in a lot of detail about the nature of ADS-CFT in our previous episode, including the fact that ADS-CFT is valid for a negatively curved universe with negative cosmological constant, so-called anti-de Sitter or ADS space, quite different from our own de Sitter universe with its positive cosmological constant. But ADS-CFT is still a powerful tool for exploring holographic emergence, and we're going to use just one part of this proposal. The CFT part. CFT is for conformal field theory. It's the laws of physics that play out on the boundary, that encode the universe in the bulk. A conformal field theory is one in which the laws governing the field theory don't care about the size scale of the objects in the theory. So you could have little wiggles in the field that interact with each other in a particular way, or gigantic wiggles that interact in exactly the same way, as long as the wiggles are the same shape. This conformalness gives us a way for the bulk to emerge from the boundary. Imagine the boundary consists of many Planck-length squares, each able to hold a single bit, 0 or 1, empty or full. You can have small-scale patterns of these bits, where each square is independent, or you could have larger-scale patterns that average over many squares. They are, as we say, coarse-grained. Because it's a conformal field theory, these large patterns experience the same physics as the smaller patterns. And these patterns can appear on many scales, all behaving basically the same. Let's add another fact. A system of particles on one scale only interacts with patterns on the same scale. They don't interact with patterns on larger or smaller scales. It's like having multiple sizes of ripples on a pond that just wash over or under each other. But there's something that's different for the coarse-grained patterns versus the fine patterns. The amount of information needed to represent them over the surface is lower. You're effectively lumping the Planck-length squares together. Let's say we're looking at just the patterns that have, say, twice the scale length of the smaller scale patterns. We can represent them by averaging square sizes that contain four of our original Planck-length squares. We can also imagine a surface containing only this pattern scale. It has quarter the number of effective squares as our original surface. That means we can also think of it as having an effective radius of half that of the original. The larger the pattern size, the more Planck squares you'll fit into the effective pixel scale of that pattern size. And that means the smaller the effective radius of the surface of that scale will be. So here's another way to represent this 2D surface with its many pattern scales. As a series of nested spheres. Each sphere represents one of those scales. The spheres near the center represent the larger scales on the boundary, where the patterns are so big they have relatively few effective pixels to play with. That's what makes the inner spheres effectively small, while the outer spheres are occupied by the boundary patterns that are finer or smaller in scale. We need higher resolution to represent them, so these spheres are made of many effective pixels and so are effectively large. But because the boundary theory is a conformal field theory, the physics on each of these spheres is exactly the same. And if the separation between these spheres is small enough, for example, if it's also a Planck length, then we've produced a 3D space out of a 2D one. Now, this is a fairly cartoonish sketch of how a non-spatial degree of freedom in a lower dimensional space can lead to an emergent space with one more dimension. The real picture is likely to be way more complicated. For example, the emergence may not come from simple scale invariance, but rather from quantum entanglement across many scales, and that's something we'll come back to another time. But the story I just told is still a useful picture to get a basic gist of what a holographically emergent space looks like, because this new degree of freedom translates to a radial direction that emergent space is in a sense inside the original space. That's why we talk about the higher dimensional space, the bulk, emerging from its boundary. Although really, the bulk and the boundary are two distinct spacetimes. It may be that each completely contains all of the information of the other, and the two evolve over time in lockstep with each other. But they evolve by very different laws of physics. There's a boundary theory and a bulk theory, and at first glance, they look like they shouldn't predict the same thing. Yet they do. They both predict the same universe. This is actually a recurring thing in physics. There are a number of places where two wildly different mathematical descriptions describe the same system or phenomenon, and often the different descriptions seem mutually incompatible. These are called dualities. And to me, they're one of the most mysterious features of reality. Now, for a true duality, there is no preferred side. Neither of the two theories are more fundamental than the other. For example, in quantum mechanics, you can represent a particle as a sum of waves in momentum space or in position space. Those are equally true, and so this is a true duality. So is the holographic duality a true one? If so, then the boundary and the bulk are equivalently real. It wouldn't be quite right to say that the interior emerges from the boundary. Instead, there's a so-called ontological democracy. Perhaps both emerge from something more fundamental, but neither is primary to the other. On the other hand, there are also such things as approximate dualities, in which one side really is more fundamental. One system causes the other system in a meaningful sense. Now, if the holographic duality is like this, then it's much more reasonable to describe one side as emergent, and the emergent side in this case is most likely the bulk. But only because in the most concrete version of a holographic duality, ADS-CFT, the boundary theory is currently better defined than the bulk theory. So, which is the case? Well, even if our universe possesses some sort of holographic duality, we don't know whether it'd be a true or approximate duality. In fact, we don't even know which type the ADS-CFT duality is. That's something we're going to have to spend a lot more time on, and by that I mean this show and the theoretical physicists. Okay, so we're back up to speed on the holographic emergence of space. In upcoming episodes, we'll see how gravity can enter this picture. Firstly, through the entropic gravity proposal of Eric Verlinde. We'll also see the modern thinking for the emergence of space through quantum entanglement and what the prospects are for finding a concrete holographic description for our universe. And as a teaser, the holographic boundary may not even be at infinite distance, but rather in the far future. And we will ultimately get to the big question: is our universe really emergent from a more fundamental, lower dimensional reality? Or are we just one side of the coin of a true duality, the boundary and the bulk, each an equally real and mutually emergent space-time? Hey everyone, the next total solar eclipse to hit North America is coming up on April 8th. In celebration of this celestial event, we have some limited time only space-time merch. For those of you who will be witnessing the eclipse, we have a specialty UV glow print solar eclipse t-shirt and sweatshirt designed by our graphics team for the eclipse. Both the t-shirt and sweatshirt are UV charged, so after being out in the sun, they'll begin to glow. The glasses, t-shirt and sweatshirt are all limited time prints, so when we're out of stock, we'll be completely out. And if you want to ensure you get your glasses and shirt before the eclipse, you have to put in your order by March 26th. So head over to pbsspacetime.com/shop or click the link in the description to put your order in now. Thank you.